afternoon. We'll be hearing from Reinhard Marconer on Cagliostro's initiation, his 1777 Grand Lodge certificate rediscovered, and followed by Mike Ford in Diesen Heiligen Hallen, debates around Freemasonry and the music of the magic flute. It should be in the headset. We're hearing the translation through the heads, the audio. If we can maybe turn that off.
Thank you.
Okay, minor technical difficulties. Okay, Reinhard, would you like to start?
Yes, thank you. The man who called himself Count Alessandro di Cagliostro became a sensation in pre-revolutionary Europe, first and foremost as a healer and magician. His supposed involvement in the affair of the diamond necklace further fueled the public's interest in this mysterious man, and his release from the Bastille, once the allegations leveled against him were found to be without merit, enhanced his status even more. All the while, Cagliostro was also active as a Freemason. In the spring of 1779, he founded a lodge in Mitau, the modest capital of the Baltic Duchy of Courland and Semigallia. Operating alongside the existing lodge Zu den drei Schwertern, the new lodge des Trois Coeurs Couronnés was open to members of both sexes and was said to enjoy the tacit support of the young Duchess Dorothea herself. Wherever he went in the years that ensued, be it St. Petersburg, Warsaw, or Strasbourg, Cagliostro would invariably seek to associate with local Freemasons. In December of 1784, Cagliostro founded a new lodge in Lyons called La Sagesse Triomphante. It was devoted to the practice of the so-called Egyptian rite that he had himself devised, consisting of three higher degrees. In the following spring, having moved to Paris, he entered into negotiations with the Philalette, who would not, however, agree to his daring suggestion that they should burn their rich Masonic archives in return for becoming privy to his secret wisdom. Shortly before his arrest later that year, he established a new lodge of adoption in the French capital under the name of Isis. His young wife was entrusted with its direction. Critical observers were bound to wonder who and what gave Cagliostro the authority to install new lodges, and where and when he had become a Freemason in the first place. His own pronouncements on these matters were as fanciful as they were evasive. But when, in the summer of 1786, having been expelled from France following his acquittal, Cagliostro was trying to establish himself and perhaps a new Egyptian lodge in London, the public was provided with a detailed answer to the latter question. It was provided by the editor of the Courrier de l'Europe, London's foremost French language newspaper. Charles Thévenot de Morande was a journalist known for his recklessness, who freelanced as an extortionist and as a spy for the French government. He had already put forth the claim that Cagliostro was in fact identical with one Joseph Balsamo, who had been to London at least twice before. When he revealed to his readers on September 8th, 1786, that Cagliostro had first joined a Masonic lodge in 1777, or more precisely, that a man who called himself Joseph Cagliostro and who professed to be a colonel in the 3rd Regiment of Brandenburg had done so. He specifically pointed to the lodge L'Espérance, which at the time held its meetings at the King's Head in Gerrard Street, Soho, and was presided over by a tapissier called Ardivier. In a follow-up article printed several weeks later, Thévenot quoted verbatim from the lodge's minutes of April the 12th, 1777. These showed that some 20 men had been in attendance that Saturday night, and it revealed more details about the two other aspiring members who were received by the lodge along with Cagliostro, an elderly Italian musician called Giuseppe Ricciarelli, and one Pierre Boileau, a valet in the service of Lord Cavendish. So this, Thévenot explained, was where the origins of Egyptian Freemasonry lay, in an assembly of lowly tradesmen, innkeepers, and servants. The editor of the Courrier de l'Europe, who was not himself a Freemason, did not go into the particulars of Cagliostro's initiation. The Compendio della Vita e delle Gesta di Giuseppe Balsamo, on the other hand, printed in 1791 on behalf of the Apostolic Camera, following the conclusion of Cagliostro's trial, made up for this by providing a lurid account of the rituals observed on that occasion. According to the compendio, which was allegedly based on the testimony of the accused, Cagliostro had to endure a number of painful and disquieting ordeals before he was finally admitted to the lodge. First, he was hoisted up with one of his hands attached to a rope and left dangling from the ceiling for a few moments. His hands still hurting, his eyes were then bandaged. He was ordered to load a pistol, which he did, and to discharge it against his head, which he understandably refused to do. Thereupon, he was made to take an oath promising blind obedience to his superiors. The pistol was handed back to him, and this time he was resolved to pull the trigger. When he did, he heard a shot going off and felt some pain. Only later did he realize that the pistol had been exchanged for an unloaded one and that one of the members of the lodge had struck him on the temple while another fired the shot. Henri Dalmeras, in his biography of Cagliostro, published in 1904, followed both Thévenot and the Compendio in his description of what happened on the evening of April the 12th, 1777, despite the fact that the two accounts cannot easily be reconciled. Dalmeras did, however, add important information by pointing out that 7 weeks later, on June the 2nd, a Grand Lodge certificate was issued for Cagliostro. In a footnote, he explained that the document he was referring to had been in the possession of the Marquis de Châteaugiron, as evidenced by a catalogue printed in 1851. In October of that year, the autograph collection assembled by René Charles Hippolyte Le Prêtre de Châteaugiron was indeed put up for sale at the auction house of Maison Sylvestre in Paris. Châteaugiron, the son of a Breton nobleman who also happened to be a Freemason, had been a French diplomat and civil servant. A founding member of the Société des Bibliophiles François, he was one of the editors of the four-volume Isographie des Hommes Célèbres, which contained a sample of Cagliostro's handwriting in the form of a letter he had written to his wife. A copy of the auction catalogue, kept here at the Bibliothèque Nationale, shows that Cagliostro's Grand Lodge certificate was advertised as rare and offered to potential bidders along with a copy of his portrait engraved in 1781 by Christophe Guérin in Strasbourg. Handwritten marginal notes seem to indicate, however, that lot 335 remained unsold. Surprisingly, the certificate is today preserved at the Sheffield Archives, where it can be found among a few scattered papers formerly belonging to Richard Monckton Milnes, 1st Baron Horton, which form part of a much larger collection called the Crewe Muniments, consisting of well over 2,000 files spanning five centuries. Richard Monckton Milnes was a Member of Parliament for Pontefract from 1837, first as a Tory, then as a Whig, and finally as a Liberal. One of the two seats representing this town in the Western Riding of Yorkshire had formerly been held by his father, Robert Pemberton Milnes. In 1816, 1763, Richard Monckton Milnes was elevated to the peerage. A man of letters and one of the first biographers of John Keats, he was known to be an avid collector of books and autographs. Milnes was unable to attend the Paris auction in person. Following his marriage to Annabel Crewe, he had left London in August for a 3 months tour in Germany, which would lead the couple all the way to Vienna. Further research would be needed to determine when and how the certificate eventually found its way into his collection. Dickie Milnes, as he was known among friends, was the son of an eminent Freemason who had served as the provincial Grand Master for West Yorkshire. But despite being a Lewis, he never joined a lodge himself, and as a collector, he was focused on erotica rather than Masonica. If a special interest in Masonic memorabilia can be ruled out, there are several other possible explanations as to why Milnes would choose to add the certificate to his collection. As an eager hunter of notorieties, he was known to be fascinated by magic and witchcraft. And having spent some time at the University of Bonn, he was also well read in German literature in general and Goethe in particular. Indeed, it may have been his encounter with Karl August Varnhagen von Ense, an acolyte of Goethe and one of Germany's most prolific autograph collectors, that first inspired him to build a collection of his own. In all likelihood, he knew that Goethe had explored Balsamo's genealogy during a short stay in Palermo and had later modeled one of his lesser plays called Der Großkofta on Cagliostro and his alleged involvement in the affair of the diamond necklace. In 1877, it was reported that Horton's precious collections had been destroyed by a fire at Fryston Hall, his country house outside Pontefract. But however great the damage may have been, it certainly didn't amount to a total loss. The Keats manuscripts eventually found their way into the collections of Harvard University, where they're being kept aptly enough at the Horton Library, named after an American benefactor. A sizable portion of the remaining autograph collection, some 280 items altogether, was auctioned off and thus dispersed as recently as 1995 at Christie's in London. It contained letters and manuscripts by famous British, American, and continental authors, including many leading figures of the Enlightenment, as well as various documents signed by eminent French revolutionaries. The Sheffield certificate, printed on parchment, is a design introduced by the moderns in 1757. It shows the three graces, with faith and hope standing on top and charity sitting next to one of the three pillars representing the orders of architecture, with an angel blowing a trumpet and carrying a lance in the sky above. Sealed and signed by the long-serving Grand Lodge Secretary, James Heseltine, it confirms that Joseph Cagliostro had been made a Mason and admitted to the third degree at a regularly constituted lodge, meeting at the King's Head, Gerrard Street, Soho, London. He had thus been raised as master within a few weeks of having entered the craft. In the bottom margin, the certificate is signed Io Giuseppe Balsamo in Cagliostro's own hand. While it was not unusual for the recipient to sign such a certificate in one of the margins, there's no ready explanation as to why it should bear this name instead of Joseph or Giuseppe Cagliostro. Another certificate issued 10 months later on March 29th, 1778, was signed in the same fashion, Io Giuseppe Balsamo, though not in the same spot. Edward Eugene Stolper was the first to describe that certificate, which was issued for Cagliostro's wife by the Lodge of Adoption, L'Indissoluble, at The Hague. He speculated that Cagliostro set out to sign as Joseph Balsamo, but suddenly changed his mind and chose to write Giuseppe Balsamo instead. However, it is obvious that what Cagliostro did in fact do in both instances was to put the person personal pronoun, io, in front of his real name. A comparison with his handwriting leaves no doubt that the signatures on both certificates are authentic. On the verso of the Sheffield certificate, three officers of the lodge, Davin, its secretary, Ardivier, its worshipful master, and Prussureau, its senior warden, declare that they recognize Count Cagliostro as a member of L'Espérance Lodge. This is confirmation that Cagliostro had introduced himself not merely as an officer, but also as a nobleman. All three signatures seem to be in one and the same handwriting, presumably Davin's. Not a great deal is known about these men and the lodge they represented. According to John Lane's Masonic records, L'Espérance, number 434, was founded in 1768 as a French lodge in Westminster. During the first decade of its existence, it would meet in two Gerrard Street pubs, either at the Turk's Head or the King's Head. The King's Head, on the corner with Newport Place, had a long history of serving as a meeting place for Soho's Huguenot community. As early as 1701, it was said to be a refuge for disaffected Frenchmen. The UGLE Library and Museum of Freemasonry possesses some of the lodge's annual returns covering the years 1777 to 1797. In 1799, L'Espérance was merged with an older French lodge, Les Amis Réunis, number 254. As to his officers in 1777, they were all different from the ones who 5 years earlier had advertised in the Morning Chronicle their St. John's Day gathering in Kentish Town. Ardivier, according to the Courrier de l'Europe, was a carpet restorer who later came to regard Cagliostro as a fraud. He may have been involved in founding the lodge L'Egalité in London in 1785. Jean-François Prussureau was a woodcarver, sculptor, and gilder. Neither he nor Davin were present during Cagliostro's initiation. Judging from two certificates, one issued by the lodge itself and another by Grand Lodge, Prussureau only joined L'Espérance a short time after the Sicilian. He had previously been a member of another French lodge in London, Saint-Georges de l'Observance. There's not much point in digging even deeper. One might find, for example, that in 1774, Prussureau married an English woman named Jane White, thus displaying his willingness to integrate into the surrounding society. It is safe to assume that, like his peers, he was a modest man. Though he may have undertaken some fairly prestigious commissions, his accomplishments as an artist are, for the most part, unrecorded by history. As someone whose own claims to nobility were spurious, Thévenot had good reason to suspect that an actual Italian count would never have mingled with the members of L'Espérance and could not have found even the slightest shred of Egyptian wisdom among them. The rediscovered Grand Lodge certificate thus confirms some at least of the results of the Courrier de l'Europe's investigative efforts. In particular, the puzzling way it was signed by the recipient can be regarded as further proof that Balsamo and Cagliostro were indeed the same person, as first alleged by Thévenot. And this despite Cagliostro's strenuous denials and contrary to the belief of some of his most recent biographers. Thank you.
Before we take a few questions here, I just wanted to point out that there's both English and French copies of Reinhard and I's work on the Illuminati, the Secret School of Wisdom. So if you were so inclined, please see Reinhard after this. Now let's open it up for a few questions. Do we have any? Yes.
Reinhard, thank you. I have a question concerning Cagliostro. Would you say that he has had any impact on Freemasonry as such, beside being a member with a famous name?
Well, I'm not an expert on the Memphis Mizraim rite or any other kind of Egyptian form of Freemasonry, but I think he was probably one of the earliest, if not the earliest, Freemason to come up with some kind of Egyptian rite. And since he was a very famous person, not just for obviously being a Freemason, but as a healer, as a magician, as some kind of magical man, mysterious man who also found a very fateful death in a remote castle in Italy at the hands of the papal inquisition. He was not only famous in his lifetime, but also became a legend after his death. And throughout the 19th century and even well into the 20th century, he was his deeds were studied, his rite was published, biographies were published about him. Fictional works, of course, Alexandre Dumas and others wrote novels about him, or theater, starting with Goethe, was interested in him, and the movie industry eventually. So he's had a wide-ranging influence, not just on Freemasonry, but also on the on popular culture and any kind of historiography of the occult, of the mysterious. So yeah, I think his legacy certainly is wide-ranging and worth exploring in many ways. And I might add that all the existing biographies are either shoddy work or very partisan, either in condemning him or in praising him. So I think more truly scientific study will be needed to further explore this mysterious man and his biography.
Do we have any other questions?
Yes, thank you for that interesting talk. I wondered if you might have some ideas about where his iconography came from, and this interest in Egyptian forms and symbols. And I can't help thinking about another Italian, Piranesi, and his decorations for the Café dell'Inglese in Rome, which had Egyptian motifs.
Well, we're talking about the age before Champollion here. So the Egyptian mysteries, the significance, the symbolism of the pyramids, the hieroglyphs, I mean, they're still puzzling to us today after 200 years of research since Champollion's deciphering of the hieroglyphs. And even more so in the 18th century. So essentially, this was a vessel into which people like Cagliostro could pour their own ideas and make them more interesting for the public. What his sources were, I'm not sure. There's, of course, Terrasson's novel Cetos, which was very influential at the time. He probably was a reader of that, and there were other accounts by travelers, all kinds of literature, and of course a lot of speculation as to what the Egyptian hieroglyphs really meant. So obviously like so many of his peers, he wouldn't divulge his sources. So it's always a matter of speculation as to what he actually read and what he was inspired by. It's impossible to come to a definite conclusion about this kind of sourcing. It's a field for open questions and discussions.
Do we have any other questions? No? Okay. Before we begin with Mike, I wanted to point out, you mentioned the Lodge Saint-Georges de l'Observance. Mm-hmm. That was also the Lodge of Pierre Lambert de Lintot, was it not?
Yes, and they had a special high degree system.
Right at 7 degrees?
Which is the subject of an interesting paper published in AQC some 90 years ago.
Okay.
And actually, I haven't studied it myself, but there's a minute book surviving at the UGLE library, which should be interesting to look at. The author of that paper, I don't remember his name now, who wrote about Lintot, he said, well, I'm going to write another essay on that minute book, but he never did. So maybe one should have another look at it. And perhaps one would learn a little bit more about Davin, for instance, the secretary of the lodge, L'Espérance, or maybe Ardivillier, I don't know. Is it that important to know? I'm not sure about that, but since we don't really have that much material on these various French lodges in London, it's at least interesting to know that one of the lodges left behind a minute book,
yes,
which hasn't been properly explored yet.
Okay, wonderful. Let's go ahead and continue with Mike now.
Thank you. I think we need a brief media break. The first one is sound, and the second one is I have some handouts that I'd like to pass around. Why don't you? Oh, thank you very much. All right, and then we should decide on the best way to get sound from my computer and into your ears. I have a Bluetooth speaker of moderate power. Is there a different way that we could get it through the sound system here? I can hold the microphone to it. Good morning. Some of this paper is a little academic, but I will intersperse it with some beautiful music. Let me begin by reading you the synopsis of the Magic Flute that the Metropolitan Opera House provides, and you have it on your handout too. In a mythical land between the sun and moon, three ladies in the service of the Queen of the Night save Prince Tamino from a serpent. When they leave to tell the queen, the birdcatcher Papageno appears. He boasts to Tamino that it was he who killed the creature. The ladies return to give Tamino a portrait of the queen's daughter, Pamina, who they say has been enslaved by the evil Sarastro. Tamino immediately falls in love with the girl's picture. The queen, appearing in a burst of thunder, tells Tamino about the loss of her daughter and commands him to rescue her. The ladies give a magic flute to Tamino and silver bells to Papageno to ensure their safety on their journey and appoint three spirits to guide them. Sarastro's slave, Monostatos, pursues Pamina, but is frightened away by Papageno. The birdcatcher tells Pamina that Tamino loves her and is on his way to save her. Led by the three spirits to the temple of Sarastro, Tamino learns from a high priest that it is the queen, not Sarastro, who is evil. Hearing that Pamina is safe, Tamino charms the wild animals with his flute and then rushes off to follow the sound of Papageno's pipes. Monostatos and his men chase Papageno and Pamina, but are left helpless when Papageno plays his magic bells. Sarastro enters in great ceremony. He punishes Monostatos and promises Pamina that he will eventually set her free. Pamina catches a glimpse of Tamino, who is led into the temple by Papageno. Sarastro tells the priest that Tamino will undergo initiation rites. Monostatos tries to kiss the sleeping Pamina, but is surprised by the appearance of the Queen of the Night. The queen gives her daughter a dagger and orders her to murder Sarastro. Sarastro finds the desperate Pamina and consoles her, explaining that he is not interested in vengeance. Tamino and Papageno are told by the priest that they must remain silent and not allowed to eat, a vow that Papageno immediately breaks when he takes a glass of water from a flirtatious old lady. He asks her name and the old lady vanishes. Three spirits appear to guide Tamino through the rest of his journey and to tell Papageno to be quiet. Tamino remains silent even when Pamina appears. Misunderstanding his vow for coldness, she is heartbroken. The priest informed Tamino that he has only two more trials to complete in his initiation. Papageno, who has given up on entering the Brotherhood, longs for a wife instead. He eventually settles for the old lady. When he promises to be faithful, she turns into a beautiful young Papageno, but immediately disappears. Pamina and Tamino are reunited and face the ordeals of water and fire together, protected by the magic flute. Papageno tries to hang himself on a tree, but is saved by the three spirits, who remind him that if he uses the magic bells, he will find true happiness. When he plays the bells, Papageno appears, and the two start making plans for a family. The Queen of the Night, her three ladies, and Monostatos attack the temple, but are defeated and banished. Sarastro blesses Pamina and Tamino, as all join hailing the triumph of courage, virtue, and wisdom. My fascination with the Masonic nature of Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart's 1791 Singspiel, The Magic Flute, was born when, about a decade ago, I read a second-rate murder mystery of which I can neither remember the title nor the author, and I hope it's not any of you. In Amadeus, the play-turned multi-Oscar-winning movie, it is suggested that Mozart's Requiem was the word that led to the composer's death. By contrast, the investigator protagonist of the novel initially postulates that Mozart was poisoned by Viennese Freemasons, punishment for his advocacy of the inclusion of women in the fraternity through the magic flute. However, as the mystery unravels, it becomes clear that the Masons did indeed not murder the fictional Mozart, but rather that they aided the Mozarts in the last years of his life, as well as thereafter. That Mozart and his librettist Emanuel Schikaneder were members of the fraternity is a well-known fact, thoroughly documented by the various lodges to which they were affiliated. Both artists created works that were implicitly or explicitly associated with Masonry, perhaps most notably the composer's Masonic funeral music and a little Masonic cantata, which is, incidentally, the last work that Mozart completed before his untimely death. Within Mozart scholarship, authors have incorporated his involvement in Freemasonry into their biographies and analyses to varying extents, ranging from detailed attempts at divining the complex web of Masonic symbols to brief mentions in music history textbooks. The Masonic nature of the magic flute has gone largely unchallenged from the first claims in the early 18th century to the beginning of the 21st century, when authors such as David Buch and J. McPherson started questioning whether the Singspiel is indeed as Masonic as previously claimed and assumed in the literature. In this paper, I contrast the opposing viewpoints regarding the Masonic nature of the music of the magic flute, emphasizing the points of contestation. Although there has been, as we shall see, a wealth of authors that demonstrate the various elements in the Singspiel that refer to Masonic practices and teaching, there has been a call to reevaluate these claims since the turn of the century. This paper is divided into four sections, each dedicated to untangling the discourse around an aspect of the music that has been alleged to have Masonic influence: the framing key of the Singspiel, its unusual orchestration, the repeated chords that have been said to allude to ritual knocks in the ceremonies of initiation into Freemasonry, and finally, numerology. After reflecting on the various authors' analytical approaches, I conclude by briefly considering the ontological status of the magic flute as a capital M, capital O Masonic opera, as Jacques Chailly and Cecil Hill and Roger Cott claim it to be, a claim that Buch vehemently disputes. My aim here is not to provide a general review of the relevant literature, but rather to scrutinize and synthesize the disputes around the topic, in part to share the possibly Masonic elements in the Singspiel with you. Perhaps unsurprisingly, in a setting of such disagreement, I propose a middle ground acknowledging that there are indeed strong references to Freemasonry in the Singspiel, but also that some of the claims of such references are often unsubstantiated. Of course, my aims and conclusions are lightly shaded by my membership to the fraternity. However, that I believe that my partial insider status, taking into account the historical distance between early 21st century English New York Freemasonry and late 18th century Austrian Freemasonry. But it does provide me with insights to which it seems many of the authors under discussion were not privy. Number one, the key. An aspect of the magic flute that receives mention in almost every discussion of Masonic elements therein is the framing key of E flat major, which has three flats, B flat, E flat, and A flat. An overwhelming number of authors maintain that E flat is a Masonic key. Indeed, Chailey claims that E flat major, the perfect Masonic tonality, while others propose a similar label for C minor, E flat's relative minor, which also has three flats. These authors and others count the number of flats and describe the key significance to the emphasis on the number three in Masonic numerology. For example, Chailey states of E flat, quote, "With the significance of number, the hieratic preeminence of E flat major is born, which brings together the three of perfection, the major of serenity, and the flats of solemnity." Those arguing for the Masonic nature of these keys often point to Mozart's other Masonic compositions, such as Die Mauerfreude and the Masonic funeral music, which are in E flat major and C minor, respectively. However, within the magic flute itself, there are many numbers that contradict the notion of E flat major as a specifically Masonic key. Although the final triumphant chorus right at the end is in E flat, the chorus of the priests, supposed Masons, in Act Two is in D major, while their march, which opens the same act, is in F major. Similarly, Sarastro, the supposed master Mason, has two arias, neither of which is in E flat, although Chailey maintains that the key is his. Let's take a listen to the final chorus to hear the majesty of E flat major. There are also instances where the inverse is the case. After the three ladies slay the serpent near the opening of Act One, they, as agents of that oppose Master Sarastro and his brethren, sing of triumph in the so-called Masonic key of E-flat major. Other numbers are also in E-flat, yet deal with love, erotic rather than fraternal, such as Tamino's aria, "Such loveliness beyond compare," when he sees the portrait of the princess. It sounds like this. While there is nothing explicitly or specifically Masonic about E-flat major, the years around the composition of the magic flute, the key was understood to have other attributes, many of which can be applied to Freemasonry with ease. The key of love, of devotion, of intimate conversation with God, through its three flats, it expresses the Holy Trinity. Religious, splendid and solemn, solemnity of priesthood, noble, solemn, dignified, magnificent, represents men excellently because of their elevated standing, and heroic, extremely majestic, grave, and serious. So E-flat major then does not point to Freemasonry specifically, but endows the music with characteristics that the composer associates with Masonic practices, including religiosity and solemnity. Number two, orchestration. Certain aspects of the choice of key might be explained considering the characteristics, associations, and limitations of the various instruments and or singers. With regards to the vocal parts, Eric Smith points out that another reason for selecting one key over another is that it suits the specific singer from whom Mozart has written the part, which is a practice that the composer often followed. For example, Tamino's leap at the beginning of Such Loveliness necessitates the aria to be in E flat. One last aspect that might have led Mozart to writing scenes that have alleged Masonic significance is the fact that a key suits the wind instruments of the orchestra well. Thompson notes that wind instruments, notably clarinets, basset horns, bassoons, and horns, were often used to provide music during the Viennese Masonic rituals. These instruments are also prominently featured in Mozart's other Masonic works, and that their inclusion and prominence in the Singspiel allude to the timbres heard during such ceremonies. In addition to the then standard wind instruments, the score of the magic flute notably also includes three trombones that all authors in question agree add an air of solemnity from the outset with the opening chords of the overture, which we'll hear in a minute. However, Buch notes that the wind instruments that Mozart uses here are not uncommon to 18th century music, particularly to opera. Number three, those three chords. At the moment when the priests reach consensus about whether Tamino is to be initiated into the order, three sets of three chords are sounded in the winds, which notably includes the three trombones, referring to, as has been argued time and time again, the three knocks on the door of the lodge when a candidate prepared in an adjacent chamber is prepared for the ceremony of initiation.
My brothers who serve the great gods Isis and Osiris, Tamino has approached us in search of the goals to which we all aspire. It is our duty to help him. Such is his worth that Pamina has been chosen to be by his side. That is why I took her from her mother, a woman who hopes to use her magic to destroy our temple. Tamino will help us defend ourselves against her.
But will Tamino be equal to the ordeal? What if he were to die?
That is for the gods to decide.
He is a prince.
More than that, he is a man. Shall we admit him? Let us take our decision. To respect the might of the gods.
The 3x3 chords in the winds also appear verbatim in the overture, 5 chords at the beginning and then later 9.
Thank you.
There are two points of divergence between Mozart's Knox and those of the candidate requesting to be admitted to the lodge. The threefold repetition and the rhythm. While the candidate is usually expected to knock only once, one times three, within the lodge, the senior officers exchange three knock patterns at various points of the ritual, leading to the three times three pattern of the chords in the overture, later in the overture, and in the march. As for the rhythmic figure, each of the degrees in masonry, at least in English masonry, into which I was initiated, passed, and raised, has its own knocking pattern. The pattern always consists of three knocks, yet in different rhythms. The first degree knock, which would have been the closest parallel to the scenario presented in the Jingspiel, is three equal knocks, long, long, long. Interestingly, Mozart never presents this rhythm with the appropriate woodwind trombone timbre in the Magic Flute. The second degree knocking pattern is long, short, long, and appears shortly before Tamino and Pamina endure the initiatory trials by fire and water, in the same trombone-heavy orchestration. The knocking woodwind choir pairing repeats only once. However, the orchestration does not conform to the previous iterations of the chords, and neither does the harmonic makeup. Additionally, the twofold repetition is at odds with the threefold repetition of the overture and the priest's deliberation, although that might be explained away, claiming that Mozart uses two knocks for the second degree and three for the third. We've heard the third degree pattern, and here is the second. In which the initiatory chords are presented, as we've heard an example ago, is that of the third degree knock, short, long, long. I should note that the three times three knocks in the rhythm that Mozart presents might be familiar to at least some of the members of the Grand Orient. Shelley spends a good deal of time on the discrepancy between the five chords at the beginning of the overture and the three times three chords that appear later. Shelley claims that five represents female lodges of Freemasonry, and thereby women in general, where three is the representation of male masonry, and thereby men in general. While the knocks themselves certainly seem to allude to the Masonic ritual of initiation, Buch maintains that there is nothing particularly Masonic about starting an overture to an opera with three chords, or five as is actually the case. The short, long rhythmic pattern dates back to the French overture commonly used by Jean-Baptiste Lully in the previous century. However, as Malcolm Davies points out, Buch completely ignores the three times three iterations, which has no other interpretation than that of Lodge Batterie. Number four, mystic numbers, gematria, and other numerologies. All the authors cited note the significance of the number three, particularly with regards to E-flat major, but also notable in the grouping of the characters, such as the three spirits, three ladies, and three temples. Several authors expand their numerological study to include other numbers, often claiming that the play of numbers form a complex web of secret meaning in the Magic Flute, leading Buch to claim that the search for symbolism, quote, has dominated scholarly discussions of Mozart's Jingspiel. I've already noted Shelley's emphasis on the opposition between numbers three and five, representing men and women respectively. He also weaves in the number four, to which he connects the elemental trials which the protagonists have to overcome. However, a reviewer points out that Shelley's mathematics are not always accurate, particularly when mystical numbers are concerned, and he hears what he wants to hear. The number three has clear symbolic meaning in Freemasonry, particularly in what is known as the St. John's ceremony, the first three degrees. Yet there are side orders to the St. John's ceremony, including the so-called Scottish Rite, which takes Masons up to the 33rd degree. Robbins Landon claims that the number of the critical degrees in the Scottish Rite are scenes of particular import in the Magic Flute. The 18th scene of Act 1, Sarastra appears with the 18 priests, reflecting the Rosicrucian 18th degree. Furthermore, Landon draws a parallel between the degree of revenge, number 30 in the Scottish Rite, and the 30th scene in Act 2, in which the Queen of the Night and her followers attempt to attack the temple. And the final scene, the 33rd, in which Sarastra and his followers stand victorious, mirrors the final degree of which the motto is chaos out of order or darkness While the specificity of the 18th priest in the 18th scene makes Landon's argument more plausible, the fact that there is no 33rd scene in Act 2, the final scene is the 30th, caused doubt over the argument's accuracy and validity. Landon and Chailey both use numerology in a limited sense, employing it when it illuminates a particular point. By contrast, Hans-Josef Ehrmann and I. Grattan Guinness both propose extensive numerological accounts of the Singspiel as a whole. The last part of Ehrmann's book is dedicated to divinations of various portions of the magic flute through Kabbalistic gematria, in which each letter is assigned a number corresponding to its position in the alphabet. And the words or phrases can then be formed from these numbers, which allude to other words with the same totals. While Ehrmann's manipulation of the numbers is quite impressive, gematria is never an exact method of analysis. The numbers and letters can be twisted to form almost any combination of words drawn from any set of notes. Additionally, the numbers are also subject to permutations and inversion, as well as zeros being added whenever Ehrmann needs to tailor his findings. Although Ehrmann's numerology has its shortcomings, it is far tighter than that of Grattan Guinness. The latter author is prepared to count anything from page to measure numbers, to notes in a melody, to the well-rehearsed number of flats in the key. He does not, however, believe that Mozart used gematria as such. Similar to his wealth of possible sources of numbers, he also ascribes significance to a wide range of numbers, including 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 10, 12, their factors, squares, primordials, and combinations. While it seems that the range of numbers would make it impossible not to find anything of significance within a given passage, Grattan Guinness is still required to alter the rules as he goes along, omitting various aspects of the score in his counting. Only in a few passages does he go beyond pointing out the numbers, which might be acceptable when the results follow his initial designations, 3 for male, etc. But when they are subverted, for example, he finds many threes in the aria of the Queen of the Night that I played as my soundcheck, and that certainly requires some explanation. Additionally, some results, quote, resist the numerological principles. This last aspect caused serious doubt on Grattan Guinness's work, that it is rife with errors, ranging from the incorrect description of the different degrees knocking patterns to an egregious claim that Mozart's clarinet concerto has 4 movements. It indisputably has 3. Numerology, in its simplest form, that certain numbers have significance in certain contexts, undoubtedly impacts the music and text in the magic flute. However, the fact that the 3 of the above-mentioned authors feel compelled to include a passage that reflects on the viability of numerology in their writing indicates that its importance in understanding the Singspiel might not be as critical as they make it out to be. To conclude, in discussing the various points of contention in the scholarship around the Masonic nature of the magic flute, 2 things become clear. The first is that, perhaps unsurprisingly, extreme accounts and grand theories do not withhold scrutiny. What emerges then is a middle-of-the-road view that Mozart incorporated Masonic influences into the work for artistic ends rather than for an underlying network of signification. This view stems from the disavowal of larger claims of hidden meaning by Chailey, Ehrmann, Grattan Guinness, and to a lesser extent, Landon, but an acknowledgement of the surface-level allusions to Freemasonry. Few authors note the reception history of the magic flute, usually arguing some point about how Mozart's audience would have understood it, or in the case of Bach, when the Singspiel became known as a Masonic opera. Davies, however, presents a different mode in which he demonstrates the various ways that which the Masonic flute has been incorporated into specifically Masonic musical practices since its premiere. He shows that some of Mozart's melodies, particularly Sarasso's aria in Diesen Heiligen Hallen, made their way into songbooks used by Freemasons in the Netherlands. In addition, he provides an example of how a later composer, W.F.G. Nicolai, was influenced by Mozart's music of a Masonic nature. Like Mozart, Nicolai also composed funerary music for the passing of a fellow Mason in the same C minor as the Masonic funeral music. The opening of Nicolai's work, however, bears remarkable similarity to that of the overture of the magic flute, using elements from both the 5 knock pattern and the 3x3 knocks. This work is unfortunately not well known or often recorded, so you'll have to endure my piano version of the opening. Thank you. clearly argues that the Magic Flute is a Masonic opera, claiming that Mozart purposefully constructed the Singspiel around Masonic illusion. Buch's focus in his refutation of a concept of a Masonic opera is also on authorial intent. However, following Davies's example, it might become clear that some, perhaps those that know the history of the Singspiel, or perhaps those that have been initiated into the fraternity, will experience the Magic Flute as ontologically Masonic. Thank you.
Well done, Mike. Do we have any questions? Ah, yes.
Always at the back and in the middle.
Making me walk.
Thank you for a most interesting paper. I have a very ordinary question to ask. Can you tell us which version you used as your illustrations and why?
The second part, the fact that it's in English helps, especially for the dialogue sections that we don't have to endure the German. This is by Leslie Garrett, Simon Keelyside, and others, conducted by Charles Makaras and the London Philharmonic. I found that the English translation was just a little more transferable to an audience and to myself as an English speaker. Had there been a readily recorded French one, I might have chosen that as well.
Bonjour. Est-ce qu'il y a la traduction qui fonctionne?
J'espère que je vais comprendre assez bien.
La question va être simple. Mm-hmm. Il y a bien longtemps, j'ai écouté une version de La Flûte enchantée sur un disque noir micro-sillon par Herbert von Karajan. Il y avait beaucoup de coupures dans cette version, mm-hmm. et je n'étais pas franc-maçon à l'époque. Un ami m'a expliqué que Hitler avait permis la représentation de la flûte enchantée à condition de couper tout ce qui était maçonnique. Et j'ai cherché à comprendre ce qu'avait coupé Herbert von Karajan, et je n'ai pas compris ce qu'il a coupé. Est-ce que vous avez regardé cette question? Merci.
Je vais vous répondre en anglais. Merci. There is a long tradition when staging a Singspiel or any sort of opera that has dialogue in it, to cut the dialogue, to just focus on the musical sections, on just the arias, to get it flowing more carefully. Of course, this is egregious to the Masonic symbolism of the opera, because a lot of the Masonic references occur in the dialogues. But I imagine von Karajan being a wonderful musician and a true believer in music, that he would like to focus on the music rather than on the dialogue. I would not suspect that it is a particular purging of the Masonic elements, but rather that it follows the convention of cutting out the dialogue in these Singspiel.
I think we can be absolutely sure that the Hitler part of that anecdote is a complete fabrication.
I've always been rather confused when people talk about different keys having certain characteristics, particularly as now we have well-tempered keys. Your explanation of three flats I'd never thought of, that's probably a good idea, but as far as the music is concerned, I don't think it really matters too much which key. Would you agree?
I would. I don't find the significance of E-flat major as convincing, particularly not to a listener. As I noted, it also has to do with the instruments. So, for example, the French horn at the time excelled when playing in E-flat major. Nowadays, the horn can play in any key, so it's no longer as significant. The same for kettle drums and the like, that at the time, there it was very pragmatic to write in those keys, and then also there are these associations with specific keys. In terms of temperament, the temperament was at the time still evolving. It wasn't as equal-tempered as we have now on a keyboard, and there were also regional differences to how instruments and how keyboard instruments would be tuned.
Do we have any further questions? I'd like to propose one. So you were mentioning in your talk about the connection with 33 degrees in the Scottish Rite, but how do you account for this, given that the Scottish Rite wasn't created until 1801?
The on the point of the 33rd, it's also wrong because there is no 33rd scene. So that casts some light on the questionable argument, and this definitely as well. Yes. So then even the 18th scene with the priests and the 18 priests is perhaps now refuted as well. Thank you.
Sorry.
No, I'm pleased with this. Yes. The more decimation there is of this, the better.
Wonderful. final question? No? Then we shall adjourn for lunch, then.
Thank you very much.
For the afternoon.
C'est bon.